So I thought for a little bit of inversions practice, we'll start with command last year, which actually we've only done a couple of times across the course. So this will hopefully be the last chance to give it a good go. So we'll just firstly take just a couple of minutes of full yogic breathing, and then I'll talk you through it as if you've never done it before. So just closing your eyes, get your hands rest on your knees, softening out through your shoulders. Sitting up nice and tall through your spine. And just easing your way into full yogic breathing. Inhaling into the belly, taking the breath right up to the chest. And allow the exhale to just be a release and a softening.
Just use your inhale to bring you back to neutral.
tail of your feet. Sway your hips, any movements that feel intuitive. Soften your gaze between the feet. Trying to search for fluidity in the spine. So on your next inhale breath, curl the tailbone forward, round and through your spine to bring the chest over the palms. On the exhale, try to tip your tailbone back first. So you ripple back to your spine, almost going into that sense of back bending. On the inhale, curling and round and forward. And on the exhale, tilt your tailbone back. Press the chest towards the shins. So three more like this. Again, just let your own breath lead you. Plenty of heat building in your tummy and your arms. And then settle your way back to down facing dog. Step the feet forward to the hands, standing forward dog. Using an inhale breath to lift your chest halfway up. And as you exhale, fold and release forward. Softening at the knees, using an inhale breath to rise all the way up with full body stretch. And the breath out can take you straight back down. Inhale to lift the chest halfway up. Exhale, placing your hands, stepping the way back to plank pose. Taking an inhale breath at the top, on the exhale, lower through to chaturanga. Breathing in, upward facing dog. Breathing out, down, facing dog. Taking 5 deep breaths here. So feel free to always avoid the jumping forward and back if it's something that you don't enjoy as part of your practice. Otherwise, you can have the energy to tonight. We'll all explore jumping forward and back together. So, from your downward facing dog, sometimes you might want your feet a little closer to your hands. Shortening your stance can help lighten you up. On an inhale breath, then coming up onto your tippy toes, push down to the floor as you exhale, go to your sprints, so you bend the knees, pushing down as you jump forward. Using your inhale breath, then to lift halfway up, and the exhale to fold in. Again, just the softness of the knees. Inhale to rise all the way up, stretching here, and on the exhale, we'll go straight back down. Inhaling Ardha Uttanasana, exhale, step or jump your way back to Chaturanga. Feeling that softness in your elbows as you go back, and you begin to pull the chest through. And now down the facing dog. You always have the option to take child's pose still if you're feeling tired, but you just need to take a break. One more round of sun salutation A, and then we'll ease into just two rounds of B. So when you're ready, inhale up onto your tippy toes. Use the exhale to bend your knees. Push into your hands as you jump forward, trying to lift your hips higher. Good. Perfect. Inhale once you get there, halfway lift. Exhale to release. Big breath in, rise all the way up. Last time, low, straight back through, just on your own breath. Inhale to lift halfway up once you get there. Using the exhale to place your palms, stepping or jumping your way back through the Chaturanga. Inhaling into your back bend, your own rhythm. Exhaling, finishing up and down facing dog. Relaxing your neck. And then this time in downward facing dog, we'll just play with some subtleties to get a different effect. So to build a little bit more heat in your core here, tucking your tailbone towards the heels very subtly, so it feels like you're doing a cow, a a calf stretch. And then what you may feel, hopefully, is a natural engagement of your lower belly here. So this will start to help warm us into some of our inversions that are very demanding on the belly and the shoulders. We'll head our way forward into a chair pose. So again, you can walk your feet or jump your feet forward. Inhale into lifting chest about halfway here. Exhale to release and fold. And then on the inhale breath, we'll bend the knees and sweep the arms forward and up. Exhaling just to sit the hips back. So the first one will go really slowly, taking some time to breathe and align ourselves to pose, and then we'll go one breath per movement. So seeing if you can find more space through the shoulders by shrugging them down away from the ears, trying to have that arm over the back of the ears. Taking one inhale breath, puff the chest, exhale to release and fold forward, breathing in to lift halfway up, breathing out, step or jump your way back through the chest. Breath into your back bend, keeping your thighs and tummy strong. Exhaling your way down to this dog. So as soon as we get here then, we'll go modern variation using the inhale to kick the right heel to the ceiling behind you. On the exhale, stepping the foot forward, turn the back heel down, breathing in to rise up into warrior one when you're ready. So heel to heel alignment with warrior one, giving you the space crossways to square your pelvis forward. So palms apart, gives you more space. Or if you want to work the shoulders a little harder, palms can come together, looking up to your thumbs. So we root down to the pinky toe edge of your back foot, which can sometimes start to peel its way up here. One more inhale breath. Exhaling to lower through your vinyasa. Go to your chaturanga. Breathing in to open into your back bend. Breathing out down, facing lower. Over to the left side, as you inhale, kick the left heel high. Using the exhale breath to step through, that heel turns down. Inhale to rise up. Exhale to set it into your legs. Squaring the hips forward, finding the best position for your arms here. So together, wide. Again, rooting into the back foot. One more inhale breath. And the exhale, take you back down. So forward and touch around the last one. Inhaling into upward facing dog. Exhale back out of Mukhashtavasana, down facing dog. So we'll stay for three more breaths here. And this time, play with lifting your tailbone. So what you find then is a softening of the belly, but a lengthening through the backs of the legs. So keeping your tailbone up towards the ceiling. So whilst we have our guidance in alignment, there's always room to kind of play those with a different intention to get a different result from each pose. Good. When you're ready, inhaling up onto your tippy toes, you can just step in, or when you're ready, pushing into the palms of the forward, breathing in to lift halfway up, breathing out to release the fold. Inhale, bend in the knees, sweep the arms up to Kutasana, and then we'll exhale to Samasthiti. Just close the eyes and take three deep breaths together. So if your heart rate is heightened, you can slow your breath, heart rate to lower. And then blinking the eyes open, one breath to movement. So when you're ready, inhaling to bend your knees, sweep your arms up. Exhale, release and fold Uttanasana. Inhaling, Ardha Uttanasana. Exhale, stepping, jumping way back to Chaturanga. Breathing in, upward facing dog. Exhaling back. Down or facing dog. Inhale to raise the right heel to the sky. On the exhale, stepping the foot forward. Back heel turns down. And when you're ready, let the inhale bring you up, warrior one. And on your own breath, the exhale can take you straight back down to Chaturanga. Inhaling your way into your back bend. And exhaling into down facing dog to close. Breathing in, keep the left heel high. Breathing out to step through. Lowers, inhale, breath rising up, expand and open. Exhaling, lowering down. Good. Inhale, pull the chest through, shoulders roll back. Exhaling, down, facing dog. Good. And again, here's that space for the breath to slow, the heart rate to lower. Good. toes, lifting and lightening the hips, exhaling, bending the knees and hopping forward. Inhaling to lift the chest halfway here. Exhale, Uttanasana. And then back to Utkatasana on the inhale breath, bend the knees, sweep the arms up. Exhaling, hands come to prayer. Perfect. Good. So we'll come over into tree pose, getting into a sense of balance. So we'll go way to the right foot to start with. And again, just giving ourselves some time to slow down. So you can keep the foot low or higher up the thigh, entirely up to you. Hands can come together when you're ready from here. So to begin with, we'll just take a few breaths. If you feel sturdy enough to take the arms up over here, then you can. Good. When you're ready from here, we're going to bring your hands down to your hips. And if you can transition from balance to balance, we'll bring that knee out in front and keep the legs straight. So in a moment, we'll use the blocks here. But essentially, what we'll try to do now is create the mechanics of what we'll do in an L-shaped handstand. So now we'll take the arms overhead and flex at the wrist, just like you had your palms on the floor. So just having a little play, I know the legs will be burning with this leg here. So to start with, we'll press the leg out, which kind of instabilizes you or unstabilizes you. So what we want to do when we're going up into an L-shape is to plug in. So now really feel a sense of if this hip is out, plugging the thigh bone in, drawing it back. One more inhale breath here, and then on the exhale, the hands come down, so you end up in standing stiff. Good. Find your breath here. You can use your fingertips on the floor just in front of your toes to draw your chest in towards your standing shin, so you get a nice big stretch on the standing leg. Now here, what we're going to do to really get a sense of where we'll be at the start of kicking up to the wall is that nice strong internal grip rotation of the back thigh. So pinky toe facing the floor, perfect. Try to kick the energy out from your back heel. So you're as straight as you can be in that back leg, perfect. And it's that power, whilst you've got your standing leg, which will be kicking to the wall, the power of the back leg pulling away from the floor will be really helpful. So from here, just playfully, we're gonna maybe hop that standing foot back a foot away from your hands, not to handstand, but just to kind of hop switch to the other foot. So just a teeny jump, switch. Good. And then let the other foot come down and we'll roll up to stand slowly. So that was just fun. Good, take your time. I'll go wait to the other foot when you're ready. Okay. So again, tree pose, but anywhere apart from the knee. Finding that equal force of the foot and thigh pressing in towards one another, lifting it out of that hip joint. So if you feel a little wobbly, your hands can stay here, or if you're ready to take them up high, you can take them up here. Softening your gaze at one point. Thank you. So when we're working with hands down, we have probably, when we get ourselves to the wall, 1 to 3 or 4 minutes before the arms are at fatigue. So we don't want to work our arms too hard before we get to that point here, but we're just going to explore again, building confidence to hold our body weight on our hands. A little bit of donkey kicks here, as if you were going for a tap handstand. So we're going to walk the feet halfway up your mat. So again, you've just shortened the stance. Gazing forward between your hands, so you create like a triangle with your gaze. So if your hands at the bottom corners of your triangle, your gaze is just ahead of that, which helps your head placement when you go upside down. And then here, we're just going to go 3 to 5, just depending on how you're feeling, how your arms are feeling at this point. So just like when we were jumping our feet forward to our hands, but instead we're going to land back in the same place. So pushing down through your arms, trying to keep them as rigidly straight. So when we talk about integrating the shoulders and wrapping them here, setting that up before you go. So trying to spin your biceps to face forward so that you feel your shoulder blades wrapping forward. So on that, inhale to the tippy toes, and then on the exhale, just going to kick the heels to the bum. And it might be really clunky, and it might be a small jump to start with, but 3 or 4 of those. Getting the heart rate to tighten. And then once you've done those, step the feet forward, hold the arms, and rest in your forward fold. Maybe our handstand position in a couple of different relations to gravity, and then we'll come to the wall. So when you're ready, wriggle your feet together so your big toes come to touch, and we'll ease our way back into the chair pose. With an inhale breath, bend the knees, sit the hips low, arms extended high. So essentially now we're going to sit a little deeper than we normally would. So this is like the up, down, upside down rather version of that. So here, feeling a sense of trying to hug your belly down towards your thighs. So when you're upside down, go for top handstand, we'll try to do that same thing of hugging the thighs into the belly. From here then, on an inhale breath, we'll rock the weight over to the right leg. And as you exhale, just start to kick the left knee up. So when you feel ready, start to tip forward. We're going to find our way into warrior 3. So suddenly it becomes really challenging to have the arms overhead. Trying to squeeze your upper arm bones to your ears. So now we're in an L-shaped handstand, but facing the ground. One more inhale breath. Exhale again to release back to that standing spin. Good. So let the neck and shoulders relax here. So you feel that big stretch in your standing leg, and you check in with that internal rotation of the back thigh. So I've heard it called deep squat, just to build a little heat in the legs here. With this back leg now, we're going to bend the standing knee and then bring that back knee to bend and touch down towards the ankle. Exhaling to kick back up to your standing spin. Just 2 more like that. Inhale, bending, crouching. Exhale, release the extent. Inhaling to bend down. Exhale to release and kick. And then on this last one, we'll lower that knee to the outside edge of the standing heel and sit down for a twist. Take a break. And Lauren, if you're too hot, please turn
that. I
am. Good. Good. So from here, just holding onto the shin to give you some traction to inhale, puff the chest up. On the exhale, find our way into the twist. So just taking a breather, turning towards that front knee. Good. Turn your gaze to look over the back shoulder. Reverse tabletop. So this will bring you into that big stretch that you feel when you're in wild thing, but with the 2 arms, it's a little more stable. So when you're ready from here, using an inhale breath to kick the hips up, and we'll stay for 3 breaths if you can. So you're trying to lift your hip bones in line with your shoulders, in line with your knees, so create one long line through your body. Good, and then slowly let your hips drop back down. And then we'll grab our blocks and bring them to our sides here. So then from here, we'll press down into the blocks. So getting into arm balancing but close to the ground. So now, with your blocks about mid-thigh, so you have somewhere to traction into. When we think about leaves and pulleys, we have something to lead them forward to let the hips lift up. So from here then, pressing down into your blocks, lifting your hips as far back as you can. Good. And then dropping the hips down, step the hands just behind, bending the knees. And how to kick the hips up, two breaths, yeah, in the stretch. Toes, wriggling your toes back together. When you're ready, using an inhale breath to rise back up into your chair pose. Exhaling, sitting that teensy bit deeper than you usually would. So you're starting to close that gap between your belly and thighs. When you're ready from here, weight starts to go over to the left foot. So you just start to kick your right heel up. And once you feel ready to start to transition forward into Virabhadrasana 3, here. So you naturally have that standing leg integrated now, like we were just practicing in our standing balance. One more big inhale breath. Exhale, release the fingertips to the ground for your standing split. So enjoy the break on your arms here. Enjoy the rest of your neck and the stretch of the standing leg. Still keeping strong and steady through that back foot, kicking energetically out through the back heel. And then just three of those chipper squats. So on an exhale, bending into your standing knee, squeezing the right knee down towards the ankle. And then breathe in to kick up and open. Exhaling to bend in. Inhaling to open. And exhale to squeeze. Last one. And the knee comes down to the outside of the left heel. So once you're there, bringing the hips down to the floor. So we come into our seated twist. using that grip on the shin to inhale, pull you into length through the spine. On the exhale, turning towards the knee. So any arm variation of your choice, you could hook the knee into the crease of the elbow or take the elbow to the outside of the knee.
None of these straps have been used, they're all clean, so you could use a strap.
If you're someone whose elbows splay out as you go up, you can strap the forearms to shoulder distance. It becomes a bit of a crutch because what it does get you to do is have a little bit of like to resist into, and sometimes that gives you a bit more power. So you can play with the strap, or you can have a block between the L shape of your hands, and sometimes that helps you to keep the position as you go up. So we'll get into dolphin pose. And then essentially from here, practicing that sense of pressing your elbows down and forward to get your chest back. But now lift your head to gaze between your thumbs again. So the gaze point in forearm stand to begin with is to the ground to help you balance as you go upside down. So you may see images of people with the head dangling and that sort of heading towards hollow back, and in time you'll be able to go up without your gaze. But to begin with, you'll probably need your gaze to the floor. So between your thumbs or between your hands, you'll experiment what works for you. You're kind of looking forward, so the head is kicking up slightly. Now walking your feet forward to your hands, so your hips are getting further and further over the head. Now before you go kicking up really powerfully, play with that real sense of plugging the legs in and getting that strong internal rotation of the back leg. So as much as your standing leg is kicking, your back leg also pulls you. So you'll find the wall, keep your gaze, dig your elbows into the ground, squeeze your belly, squeeze your thighs. So you can point your toes or flex the feet. So naturally, you always turn the heating off.
Now I'm sweating the fire option.
This is not a necessity.
This is like being essential.
And so if it is, use though, because you're quite strong as well, if you find that you have shooed off your spell, fear is the limiting factor.
Yeah.
With playing with kicking up, you can play with starting with your head on the floor. It's much, much harder to get up. Excuse me. If your head's on the floor, like as if you were in a headstand,
yeah.
I'm not sure if I can do it anymore, but I could at one point. So you can play with being here, that's comfort zone for you. So you get your feet to the wall, and then you get that same grip and see if you can lift up from there. So it means that you have got that power of throwing yourself up. So headstand position though, so you've got two sort of bent and elastic. Perfect. So it removes that fear of throwing your body up.
That's really good.
And so child's pose is usually ready for child's pose.
Good.
So what we're aiming for in the forearm stand, eventually, you do kind of naturally banana back a little bit to begin with, just to get that kind of stacking effect of balancing. That's it, Louise. So we'll head there. Good. And so it's really nice. What you're doing there, Louise, is a really nice thing to say if you're going to school for the first time, because having your toes pushing into the wall gives you something to propel and pull your chest through, so you get that C-shape going. Without the wall, it's much, much harder to try and pull the chest through and balance your weight from side to side.
My goal is to be in 40 next year.
So as you've gone there, we'll go there and we'll do handstand and the scorpion handstand.
I'm just like,
to cool down and stretch it. So again, it is all just playful exploration. You're tired, your arms are shot after that first round, too much relax. So the difference then, So what you're aiming for in the full forearm stand in time is a straight line, hopefully an ish straight. So you're contracting through your core, so there's not too much back bend. Then when you start to come into scorpion, the chest has to pull through. So you're pulling as if I'm trying to touch the wall now with my head.
I just don't know if
it bends that way. And then your toes are squeezing. So you're trying to squeeze your heels as tight to your bum as you can, but it's that. The act of kind of pulling. So suddenly, instead of your chest being like parallel with the arms, you're trying to pull your chest, so your chest is becoming more and more parallel with the ground.
But like, you're not like you're like, I know with the anatomy of my back, or that I'll never reach
that potentially. Like, but just to balance, you want to just balance. So the wall there to help is fat, and you would just then at 100 degrees move like a little bit further away from the wall in time, so you know you'll never go all the way over. The wall would still catch you, but you start to get to play and balance in space.
And then where do you go after the wall? Like, in terms of someone to hold you?
Just from my ankle personal experience, I've never gone over.
No.
Like if I use balance, you tend to kind of, you can pull your chest through and you'll just, your feet will come back down.
Yeah.
Just, so there, exactly. You can just slow you one at a time, start to bring the toes. Yeah, exactly.
Great job, Liz.
Oh, yes, please.
To kick up to your forearm stand. I actually am no longer as confident to go up into forearm stand in free space as I used to be ever since I had Freddie. I don't know why. I just feel, I've never fallen, but it's just, I have to often go to a wall now. I don't know why. It's not the same with handstand, but once you're confident to go up into your forearm stand in free space, then you'll feel confident to start to play with that, pulling your chest through.
Okay.
So building that, the forearm stand in free space first. And again with that, you never really kick and go, you know, head over heels, but you might just go sideways. I guess you can just the shoulder potentially going sideways, but yeah, you just come up a little bit further and further away from the wall. So we're probably hitting towards the teeth now. Just have a little play with those two variations in handstand. So it'll be exactly the same setup, but what's making it harder is that lengthening of the inversions. Immediately you're adding the length of your forearm now and your balance, like your foundation's immediately got narrower because you haven't got that nice long line of your elbow balancing between your hand, and your hand is quite big and your forearm's quite long. So immediately now we've lengthened the levers and made our point of balance a lot narrower, which is what makes handstand harder. Some people find it easier though because if your shoulders are tight, you lose that restriction because you can go wider with your hands. Men, you do sort of tend to see them because they're stronger but sometimes more inflexible in their shoulders. They go up in like bent arms, but they can hold themselves there. And like you can see people online, they sort of walk along with their hands and their back stays banana the whole way, but they can kind of catch up with their body weight. So as the feet are going over, their hands just catch up with their feet. So you've got a bit more room to play and be misaligned really in a handstand. But what we're looking for is hands at shoulder width, and what we're looking for eventually is your arms might not be able to stay straight. When your arms start to get tired as well, your elbows begin to bend as you're kind of giving way. But you're trying to keep your arms going against everything we often say about locking joints, but you are trying to keep your elbows locked out so that you are actually using a little bit of your joints to stabilise you as well as your strength when you're going up into handstand. So hands at shoulder width. I do play here with my hand placement even still now just to see what gives me more space. So you might, as you can do a downward facing dog, you might want to just explore your own bodies tonight or at home, maybe turning the hands very slightly outwards, which if you are restricted in your shoulders helps you get that external rotation, which might help you stay straighter at your elbows. You can find your elbows bending a lot, giving in a lot. Sometimes I can try that just to see if it helps. So the same would be exactly the same in coming up. So about forearms, just over forearms distance away. And then again, walking your feet a little closer in.
Sorry.
And pushing down into your palms. So that back leg lifts up, just like we did in standing split. So again, the back leg is going to pull away from the floor, just as you're going to bend and power up from your standing leg. So press the arms straight, biceps forward, so you have your traps wrapping. And then from here, look up.
Are we going up?
So just have a little kick. So trying to get your heel to the wall, and exactly the same again. Your gaze point is just forward of the hand, one foot at a time, trying to come away. But as you bring your feet away, squeeze your bum, your thighs, and your tummy, and your arms. So you're trying to squeeze your forearms rigidly straight. And my most recent discovery, because most of the pictures that I post and most of the videos that I do are in that staggered leg variation, I can balance much easier in that because you have that wide stance of your legs. But head placement is everything. So if your head is kicking too far towards the wall, you pull your legs back down to the floor. So I would say you are still gazing between your hands, but sort of ears in arm down the floor, and like we practice and check.
Got such good balance.
Really like the legs.
Oh, 10 pounds from Tesco. But yesterday, but they used to tree pose because they're cheap, they're like,
so that you can almost like rest at the wall, maybe to start with. Yeah, like that, yeah, exactly. But just a few more inches. That's it, you're there, feel that?
Yeah.
So if you can do like an extra inch of power in that kicking leg and see if you can, yes, almost there. I think if your weight went a little bit further forward into your hands, then it would give you that time to rest your weight over your hands there. But I think it's that you've got your momentum and you've just hit it and then it's coming straight back down. It feels a teensy bit more momentum so that your hips, when you can tighten over your shoulders, it'll give you time to rest. But obviously, again, I know your arms are probably really feeling the burn right now.
Doing great, guys.
So you probably still need your gaze to the floor, Louise. Your head's about right. Just using your gaze very slightly. Good, good. Playing with the head position has been a revelation.
But not like that.
Because if you, as soon as your head goes too far now my legs come back down to the floor. So try to get just the right amount. So probably, if I squeeze my arms, about there. But as soon as the head moves, too much that way, your legs go, and it's really like it's a small part of your body, but it really makes a big difference. So then again, if your arms are tired, you can skip it, but exactly the same mechanics would be for scorpion pose. So it is very similar to Dhanurasana, but it's a slightly bigger back bend. You're trying to get much more into your cervical spine, into your upper back. So you would potentially come a bit further away from the wall. If you're ever playing with like full wheel at the wall, you could be a leg's distance away, which feels quite far when your hands go down on the floor. The wall is a lot further away than when you're doing your handstand. But if you've got a leg's distance, you know that your legs will definitely reach, but you'll feel in space, you're like, where's the wall? So you can play with, like, in terms of shoulder stretches here, you can play with really trying to straighten your arms for getting a shoulder earth down your asana, but also I'm here, so same as in forearm stand, chest is pulling through, but you have a little bit more room to play. You're bringing your feet away. So it gives you that room, it's still there to catch you, but again, it's not, the alignment of the upper body is not the same.
So what's that called? That's handstand ball.
So they're all scorpion pose, but forearm scorpion or handstand scorpion. I'll think of the Sanskrit for it in a minute. And of course, like, if that's too far to start with, you would just work from closer and go further away. Yeah,
I'm
starting
today.
Good. Did you feel that, Louise?
That's okay. Well, as far as I was expecting it to be.
Yes, okay. and the fear factor definitely changes straight away. So if that's the case, then just go like a walk your hands a teeny bit closer, so a bit further away than normal, but not quite as far that it makes it too scary to go up completely. That's it, you're really trying to pull your chest through. Yes, Louise, yeah. And squeeze your heels to your bum. So it's kind of like all of the shapes that you already know and already do, all kind of come together to build these kind of poses.
Good, Lauren.
You can also do it again when you're at home, like on pillows or the seat of your sofa is quite a nice one to press your head into. So you're actually your head is being held and your arms are being held, and you just play and work with your feet over. That's it, chest through more. Good. Yay!
It's fun.
That's kind of the mechanics you want. So everything that we've done with like shrugging in of the shoulders, that helps you to pull your chest through.
Is it shrugging?
It's not working yet, we're just going to stretch. Just going to stretch it out. So yeah, we'll pull our mats back. That's where we were starting. But that awareness of your consultants, and like also your students will be taking on that information just over time. And you might sometimes think, oh, have I taught that enough, or have we done this enough? But in terms of like when to know, when to take people a little bit further, I would say, like if you say you want to teach headstand, dolphin is also a great prep for headstand, because you start to really use your shoulder blade muscles and get into the space of the upper back. So if someone can hold dolphin for like a minute, I would say that that person is probably ready to begin to explore whether it be tripod headstand or holding the head. So when you feel like you want to start to bring things like that in, you might do it. That's where your course is, like setting up a course would be great, because you know now how to sequence using each body part that the peak pose or whatever it is that you want to explore utilizes. So like we've done tonight, we're playing with the plugging in of the thigh, which we didn't actually do at all, but the plugging in of the thigh would be to play with like L-shaping upper legs. So you use all of those preparatory things in one part sequence. That's how you build your sequences. But that you can use that same methodology, is that right, to build a course. So it might be like, say you're doing a 4-week course to build up towards headstand. You might just start off with the sun salutations, teaching how to use your shoulders in plank pose, going down to chaturanga, and then you build into like dolphin in like week 2, and then in week 3 you might start to set up the placement of the arms and just get into being here and get people comfortable to be here and lifting one leg at a time. It's all about sort of supporting people through their fears and helping them to build confidence in their own body, that they feel when you get them to being at the wall, that person's like, yeah, actually I think I might be okay. Whereas if you throw people in that class environment where you just have the hour, and even if you know that your students are ready, they may not know in themselves that they're ready. So they have those barriers of fear when you take them to wall space. But to have a course that you kind of set out a sequence each week to kind of teeter very slowly up towards that big shape. Again, you can just use different poses that utilize the muscles, like the core strength that you use in handstand, forearm stand, and headstand. They all require you to really squeeze your tummy and integrate that middle part of your body that really wants to bend and be unstable. So you can use all of that kind of foundational stuff that you've learned here in your class sequencing to go on and sequence like whole courses and sell something really individual to what you want to teach. It doesn't have to be handstand or scorpion pose, but that's the mechanics. So the poses that you're already doing and that you're already teaching, like bridge pose builds into full wheel in time, and that full wheel, like again, if you practice ashtanga, or if that's part of your practice, the whole like tip-top and kicking over, that kicking from full wheel and kicking back over to standing, well, that would be potentially preparing you for scorpion and the opposite way, but they all kind of lead to the bigger version of it. So
I don't think that would teach you to really love to stand over.
But no, you can do that, Lauren.
No, I can participate
in that. Yeah,
to
an extent, yeah. I've taught scorpion before, but my toes don't touch my head, so I can't do the full expression, but I will hold it in space so I know how to talk through what my arms are doing. So I think if you can do it yourself in your own body, you can almost commentate. Yeah, and you can say, right, this is what your legs should be doing, and this is what your feet, and you know what you're trying to encourage people to squeeze and to move. And you'll also have your own experience of like the pitfalls that you've overcome. So, you know, like for example, with you being afraid there, Zoe, you can say, look, when I first started, like I had this real fear of doing this, that, and the other, but this is what I did to try and overcome that, so that might work for you. And that's what makes you all then completely unique as a teacher, because you all have your own unique experience of what brought you to like get to that point in your practice, not achieve or accomplish, but oh, I got to that point in the pose, I overcame that fear, or I overcame that limitation in my physical body by doing this, that, and the other. So you almost create your own step-by-step plan, and then you share that with other people, and it might work for some and not for others, but you're still sharing your experience in order to allow those people to get deeper experience of their own practice, which is what we will do in time. So with that in mind, after we've worked shoulders really hard and worked the tummy really hard, we just take a little puppy pose to start to stretch them out. So we'll just come on one of the basic
ones.
So like, that's it. So probably
the room is sick and too comfortable.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So, like,
literally, I could stay here all day.
Yeah.
It's like my favourite one.
Do you have a charity?
I could literally stay here for ages.
That's a good idea. I could do it, but not.
So, arm stretching forward, chest towards floor.
Good. I tried this with my partner because this is like adequacy. I mean, I love your chest, but I'm not stretching.
Yeah, so he's probably like, I'm a little.
Yeah, because I don't find it.
Yeah, so exactly. This is always a really nice one to do after any sort of strong class on the arms, even if you're just doing a lot of moving through the vinyasa to release the shoulders. And I think potentially some of the really athletic styles miss this opportunity to really stretch out after the strength stuff. So just taking this time. Right hand back very gently, just to support you there to come into that thread and needle. So opposite arm thread and underneath, taking it really slowly, so just lower onto the outside of the arm. If once you're down, it feels good to then re-straighten that arm out to deepen your stretch, you can. So trying to square your hips here. And if you don't feel much sensation in the outside of the arm in the stretch, then try to, whilst you're in that kind of twist position, square your chest towards the floor. Is that deep at all, Zoe? Not much.
I think I'm just...
Yeah, you're quite hyper-flexible in your shoulders, aren't you?
Just
quite. Unique. So when you're ready to come out of this, you might want to walk that straight long back just to support you to press up and out. Taking an inhale here, exhale, closing the arm underneath, and then again, if you want to, that supporting hand can walk its way forward just to deepen. So, Zoe, if you moved your torso like that way a little bit, like your whole, not your legs, no. Yeah, your upper body, but leave your knees still. Depends on the person's body to body, but you might stay there something for the ear to come down to the ground, you can rest it. You can keep that hand in front of you, or it can wrap behind your back to any extent. So it might be that the back of the hand just rests against your back. For some people, they can bring the hands to the vines, but again, that's not something that I'm able to do. But in time, people can kind of rest over here and bring their arms to me. Somewhere. So we just take a couple more breaths here.
Keep
And again, some people are comfy to just lay their arms overhead. That's probably about my limit without too much force. But if you feel good to just lay your way down to your back, stretching your arms overhead would be like, again, that lengthening of levers, bringing you into the deepest expression that you can find in reclined hero's pose. So we're doing that block. I'm trying to keep your knees hugging together. Again, now if you were doing restorative version, you can strap the knees together. Yeah, you can wrap a strap around the knees, which would stop them from slipping.
I'd probably stop them.
And then about 5 or 6 breaths would be enough.
Just hurts my skin.
Your skin, what you
mean? It's like, I don't know what you mean. It's like, that's one of the only ones that falls on my skin.
Your skin?
Yeah, your knees.
What was that? That
bit
there.
I've been caught like here.
And then, like,
often really stimulating classes. It's often much easier to soften everything here because it's already worked so hard, it's just ready to release and let go. So just having that little shift through your pelvis and wriggle out through your shoulders. Just using your breath to help you deepen this sense of relaxation. So coming back to deep inhale breaths. Just walk off into one side.